This is the day which the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is a wonderful day. A little cooler than yesterday, that's okay. We are so glad that God is with us. God is great. Jesus is wonderful. And the Holy Spirit wants to do something in our lives today that will make us different people in the week ahead. Better, braver, more beautiful people than we were when we came. Our psalm today is Psalm 4, and it goes like this. Answer me when I call to you, my righteous God. Give me relief from my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. How long will you people turn my glory into shame? How long will you love delusions and seek false gods? Know that the Lord has set apart his faithful servant for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. Tremble and do not sin. When you are on your beds, search your hearts and be silent. Offer the sacrifices of the righteous and trust in the Lord. Many, Lord, are asking, who will bring us prosperity? Let the light of your face shine on us. Fill my heart with joy when their grain and new wine abound. In peace I will lie down and sleep. For you alone, Lord, make me dwell in safety. Shall we pray? Holy Father God, as we come into your presence today, we are so grateful that you answer us when we call to you. You are a righteous God. You only do what is right, and you set the standards for what is right. I ask God that because of our time together, we would be strengthened to live for you in the week ahead. Fill our hearts with joy. Give us your peace. For you alone, Lord, make us dwell in safety. May this hour bless our hearts and be a blessing to your heart. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. If you feel like standing or sitting, but just join with us in a spirit of worship this morning.
Light.
Psalm 119, verse 25 says, "My soul cleaves to the dust. Revive me according to your word." In other versions, the word revive is also used as words like quicken and give me life. And that picture of revival just has such a beautiful picture. And I just think of this week and just this bursting of spring. I know that in Saskatchewan, like, winter keeps coming and coming, and then we get a taste of spring, but then it's back to winter again, and we kind of go through that cycle about two or three times. But didn't it just feel this week that it was like that coat of winter was just taken off? And I just feel so much like that happens in our spiritual lives, that we get this burden of this cold, dreary winter, and now we're coming into spring, and it's dry out there, and I think we're feeling a little of that urgency of that rain. And I know that when those rains come, it's going to wash away the last remnants of winter and just refresh the land. I just look forward to that, and I look forward to that in my own life, that God would just, the Holy Spirit would just come and pour that rain and just wash away some of those cobwebs that have been accumulating over the last few months. And I just pray that for you, that God's Holy Spirit would be something fresh for you today and well into the weeks and months and years ahead.
We pray, revive us.
scripture reading today comes from the letter of 1 John. We're going to read chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. And it goes like this. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Dear friends, now we are the children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. All who have this hope in Him purify themselves just as He is pure. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. But you know that He appeared so that He might take away our sins. And in Him is no sin. No one who lives in Him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen Him or known Him. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as He is righteous. This is the word of the Lord. Our gospel reading today comes from Luke, chapter 24, and we'll read verses 36 through 49. While they were still talking about this, Jesus Himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking that they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your mind? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When He had said this, He showed them His hands and feet. And while they still did not believe, it was because of joy and amazement. He asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave Him a piece of broiled fish, and He took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then He opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in His name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." When I was a boy, the basics of a good education consisted of the three R's. Do you know what the three R's are? Reading, writing, and arithmetic, right? Okay. And if you spell all those words with an R at the beginning, you need to go back and study your three R's. Now, today's lesson can also be summed up with three R's. And those three words are reappearance, reassurance, and revelation. My wife had suggested to me that I call the message today the three R's in the school of Jesus. But I decided on a little more basic sort of title and simply called it Believe the Evidence. First of all, let's talk about the reappearance of Jesus. This is based on Luke chapter 24, verse 36. While they were still talking about this, Jesus Himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." The disciples were talking excitedly. Some of them, both men and women, claimed that Jesus was alive. In fact, that they had seen Him and talked with Him. But some were troubled and some were doubtful. While they were still talking about this, Jesus reappeared. He stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." This was on the evening of the Resurrection Sunday. Jesus' disciples were becoming more and more convinced that Jesus had actually come back to life again. But many, maybe even most of them, still had doubts. It was important to Jesus that his followers would not lose their faith in him and that they would believe in his resurrection from the dead. Faith is not belief contrary to the evidence. Rather, it is an embracing of the evidence. God has provided ample evidence. If we choose not to believe, it is not for lack of evidence. There is abundant evidence for the historicity of Jesus, that he really lived, and that the Bible stories of his life are true. And there is abundant evidence for the truth of the resurrection. As the disciples were together behind locked doors, there was only one topic of conversation that day. The reports that they had heard from Mary Magdalene, from Peter and John, and from Cleopas and his companion who had been on the road to Emmaus. As they were talking, as they were excitedly continuing their conversation, suddenly and unexpectedly, Jesus reappeared and stood among them. Now, he didn't come through the door in the usual way. That was locked. And they didn't see him sort of materialize through the wall. He just suddenly appeared there among them and spoke these words, "Peace be with you." There are people who consider themselves too intellectually sophisticated to believe in the resurrection. Thinking themselves to be wise, they become fools. This week, I listened to an address by Dr. Francis Collins, one of the most brilliant scientists of our time. He is a physician and a geneticist. He served as the director of the National Institutes of Health in the USA, and he headed up the Human Genome Project. He grew up, in his words, without much of a spiritual perspective. He believed in the scientific method. He was an agnostic, and his agnosticism led him into atheism. But science did not help him to understand the meaning of life and the reality of mortality. He was challenged by one of his patients as to what he believed about God. And he realized that his atheism was dangerously thin. So began a journey of discovery, which led him to conclude that atheism was the least rational of all the choices. He quoted G.K. Chesterton, who said, "Atheism is the most daring of all dogmas, for it is the assertion of a universal negative." In other words, it's impossible to prove atheism, and it takes more faith to believe that there is no God than to believe that there is. Dr. Collins came to realize that belief in God, while impossible to prove, is the most rational of all choices. The scientific evidence cries out for a creator. The universe had a beginning. There is something instead of nothing. But he wondered, could the Creator actually care about him as an individual? Then he met a person who not only claimed to know God, but to be God. That was Jesus Christ. Dr. Collins had thought that Jesus was a myth, but the historical evidence for his life, for his death, and yes, for his resurrection, was utterly compelling. As the truth of the New Testament sank in, he realized that he was called to make a decision. He could not resist any longer. With some trepidation, he knelt in the grass on a dewy morning somewhere in the Cascade Mountains, and he became a Christian. The resurrection has as much relevance for us as it did for those early followers of Jesus. We need to know that Jesus is alive and that he stands with us in difficult times, like when a loved one dies, when our marriage is in trouble, when we experience job loss and financial hardship, when we go through loneliness, illness, and pandemic. Perhaps you are being buffeted by the realities of life. You feel like you are caught in a hurricane. I was caught in an actual hurricane years ago while competing in a motorcycle endurance event that was termed the 848. We were given 8 days to ride our motorcycles through all 48 lower states and bring back proof that we'd been in those states in the form of a credit card receipt. Now, just to make it a little more challenging, the rules for the 848 required that we begin and end in Denver, Colorado. I was riding in the state of Virginia when I came into a hurricane that had moved up from the Gulf Coast, and it was fierce. The winds were like winds that I'd never experienced before. The rain was just pelting down. It felt like it was going to be driven right through me. There was very little traffic on the freeway. In fact, I was pretty much the only one out there. At one point, I stopped to take a break in a Waffle House, and the rain was coming through the roof and soaking the floor, and people were crowded in because their houses were being even more damaged by the hurricane. And I watched through the window as a small creek, a stream on the other side of the highway, gradually swelled to become a great river, and it got so high that it came up and flowed around a house that had probably been sitting there for 40 or 50 years. And all of a sudden, the water lifted that house right off of its foundation and carried it away. I mean, it was an awesome, awesome thing. But you know, the fascinating thing about hurricanes is that in the eye of a hurricane is a place of perfect calm. The winds rage all around, but there is a place of peace at the center. And so it is for us in the storms of life. With our Lord as our center, we have peace in the midst of the storm of life. Jesus says, "Peace be with you." Secondly, we want to talk about the reassurance of Jesus. And this is based on Luke 24, verses 37 to 43. Although the disciples were beginning to believe that Jesus was alive, when he suddenly appeared, standing among them, they were terrified. They thought that they were seeing a ghost. Isn't it something how terror sparks within us a rise of our most fearful superstitions? But Jesus calms their fears by showing them that he is not a ghost. He has a real physical body. He draws their attention to the scars in his hands and feet where the wounds had been. Their fear turned to joy and amazement, but they still had a hard time believing what they were seeing. So Jesus provides with even more evidence. He asks them for something to eat. Ghosts don't eat. So they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and he ate it in their presence. Our Creator God uses the things of the natural world to teach us spiritual realities. At the beginning of this year, I started once again to read through the entire Bible. Currently, I am reading through the book of Job. And the other day, as I was reading in Job, I found a passage in the God's Word translation that struck me in a way it never had before. It had to do with how creation gives evidence of the existence of God. Job, although he was in a time of great suffering, had some very wise things to say. And this is something that he said: "Ask the animals, and they will teach you. Ask the birds, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. Even the fish will relate the story to you. What creature doesn't know that Yahweh's hands made it? The life of every living creature and the spirit in every human body are in his hands. No wonder the Apostle Paul wrote, "For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse." The scriptures, both Old and New Testament, give clear evidence that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. On this occasion, Jesus reminded his followers what he had told them repeatedly during his time with them. "Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Those are the three components of the Old Testament, or the Tanakh, as the Hebrew people call it. The Torah of Moses, the writings of the prophets, and the wisdom literature, like the Psalms. A well-known preacher with a big church and a large following recently affirmed that Christians must unhitch, that was his word, their faith from the Old Testament. I was saddened when I heard that. Frankly, that's heresy. I'm not saying that the man is not a Christian brother. He is. But that is a wrong teaching about God and his word. Jesus himself used the Old Testament in all its parts as evidence of his death and his resurrection. And that was after his resurrection. And so we come to part three, the revelation of Jesus. Now, when I use the word revelation today, I'm not talking specifically about the book of Revelation at the end of our Bibles. I'm talking about the fact that Jesus is revealed in the scriptures. Our passage today tells us he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. Any person who attempts to unhitch their faith from its Old Testament roots needs to have their mind opened by Jesus. For this is what is written there: "The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day." The death and the resurrection of Jesus are the very centerpiece of our faith. Jesus goes on to say, "Repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." Our preaching reveals Jesus. In case anyone is thinking, "Well, Pastor, that's your job. I'm not a preacher." And you think that that lets you off the hook. Well, no. Jesus says, "You, all of you, plural, you are witnesses of these things." What things? The death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. I encourage you to invite your friends and your neighbors to come to church, the services of the church, or at least to join us online. But don't stop there. Share the story of Jesus with them. Tell them about his death and his resurrection. Tell them about the difference that he has made in your life. You may be the only Bible some people will ever read. By your witness, Jesus is revealed. You don't have to do it in your own strength. Jesus promises you power from on high. That is, his Holy Spirit will give you the words to speak. Successful witnessing is simply sharing the good news about Jesus in the power of the Holy Spirit and leaving the results to God. Receive the benediction. Jesus said, "Peace be with you." Jesus said, "I give you my peace. Not as the world gives do I give you peace. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Amen.
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky. The heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are
Lord.